A further case study that we really need to look at concerns the central trust of a small self-administered pension scheme. As James will tell you, being a financial advisor sometimes means being a trustee and having to advise trustees on how to operate their particular trust. A small self-administered pension arrangement is governed by a trust, and therefore the trust is governed by trustees who may well look to you for advice. A small self-administered pension scheme, SAPS, is usually set up with fewer than 12 members comprising the directors of a close company. It may involve some senior employees, but that would be very unusual. James's baptism was extremely pleasant, though, as is quite often the case, it was born out of nothing other than a chance meeting, a passing comment, and a twinkle in a managing director's eyes. Ken Blades was extremely concerned about his employees' group pension arrangement and called James in. And whilst James was considering that and pulling it back onto track with the superannuation fund office, Ken asked him to look at the two pensions that had been set up for himself and his co-director, Reg. It transpired that the documentation for the director scheme was no better organised than the employee's pension scheme. A fair amount of work had to be carried out to draw all of the loose ends together. It was during that process that James mentioned to Ken that, with their profitability, they should really look at buying a factory, using the pension scheme to do so. "Well, we are looking to buy our own factory," said Ken. "In fact, we're just about to buy the land to build the factory on." Jingo Engineering was a very profitable company run on a very tight rein. Its problem was that it was forced to pay a lot of corporation tax, or, alternatively, the directors had to receive unwarranted and unwanted remuneration by way of bonuses or dividends. With the employee scheme now well sorted, and the two directors' executive pension plans accepting modest monthly premiums, it was decided to take £50,000 and place it in a preferred property trust, a SAS. In effect, the trust was like a second company, and that was how James described it. It was a company that had no employees, no national insurance, no income tax, capital gains tax, or inheritance tax, and what was more, it was not eligible to pay corporation tax. The company was an investment company, so it could invest in a wide range of real assets, including industrial property, and had the power to borrow money. On this occasion, an insurance company provided all of the company formation documents, and the trustees were nominated. And this gives rise to the first major point. James had two options. He could advise that the directors select Jingo Engineering Limited to act as the trustee. Or he could suggest that two or more individuals, probably Ken and Reg, act as trustees. Can you see why this might be a difficult decision to make? Take some time. Think about it and come back in a moment. Thanks for that. Ken and Reg decided to stick with individual trustees, themselves, plus one professional trustee, and of course, the essential fourth person, the pensioner trustee. Ken and Reg were aware that in the long term, the company may well be sold. In the event that the company was sold, they would effectively be removed as directors of the company. Their removal as directors would emasculate their decision-making capability. If the company was the trustee, then they could well be disenfranchised and lose control of the assets of the pension scheme. If they, individually, act as trustees, which, as I've stated, is the course that they took, then if the company was sold, they would still remain as trustees. They could then exert some governance with regard to the assets of the pension scheme and ensure that they, as individuals, were dealt with fairly. There has been a considerable amount of change with regard to trustees in recent times, and that will go on into the future, I'm sure, but I doubt that that will change the need to define quite clearly who is going to act as trustee and why they would want to. A new term has been mentioned, a pensioner trustee. This particular trustee is an essential element of any small self-administered scheme because the scheme cannot exist without an input from a pensioner trustee. It is this trustee's responsibility to oversee and, in fact, police the trust, its investments, loans, incomings and outgoings. The pensioner trustee, in this instance, was provided by the insurance company. On other occasions, the position may well be filled by an independent actuary or other qualified pensions practitioner, perhaps a member of the Pensions Management Institute or Chartered Insurance Institute. The status of pensioner trustee is conferred on an individual about what was known as the Pension Schemes Office, previously the Superannuations Fund Office. One of the peculiarities of this type of trust is that the person who pays the premium, normally the settlor or grantor, can also be a trustee, though they cannot be a pensioner trustee. They can also be a beneficiary. That individual could also be the investment manager and the administrator. What James had to achieve was to ensure that Ken and Reg knew which hat they were wearing at any particular moment in their conversation. A trustees meeting would go something like this. James, the advisor, you have £50,000 in the pension scheme. Where would you like to invest it? The question is asked of Ken and Reg, the trustees. Ken and Reg answer as directors of the company. Well, the company wants to buy some land and build a factory on it. Can we use the money for that? And of course, that question is directed to the trustees, Ken and Reg. Reg, acting as a beneficiary and scheme member. Yes, but if the pension scheme's money was used for the factory, how would that affect my benefits? And so on. You can hear the change of intonation and visualize the alteration in personal stance as the discussion builds up. Just imagine the discussion lasting for 20 or 30 minutes and see how confused and convoluted that conversation could get. Feelings can run very high. What did transpire was the fact that the trustees were empowered under the trust to borrow money and could, in fact, borrow up to 2/3 of the value of the property that they were going to build, including the cost of the land, by way of a commercial mortgage from their bankers. The trustees elected to take up the loan on a drawdown basis, purchase the land, make some more profit in their business, and then put some more money into the pension scheme. As trustees, they borrowed a much smaller amount than they thought they were going to and had the factory built. By and large, any pension scheme investment has to show a return. Pension schemes, as we said, are not allowed to trade. Therefore, any assets that are held ordinarily need to generate some form of investment income. Jingo Engineering were going to occupy the factory premises now owned by the trustees of the pension fund, and so a lease had to be drawn up to enable the company to establish the terms of its tenancy, duration, review dates, and so on, with evidences of the commerciality to the agreement. This brings in another point. All of the transactions had to be carried out at arm's length. Just because the same individuals were metaphorically running around the room putting on different hats to establish a mutually beneficial sequence of events, they had to be very sure of their responsibilities to whichever position they held during the respective conversations. It is a difficult juggling act on occasions, and one, in this instance, which James had to chair very closely indeed. But it was good fun, in a serious sort of way. The trustees had to negotiate a rent with themselves, as the company proprietors wishing to occupy the factory and do it fairly. This was not the position for Anne and her SIPS contract. An external valuer acting for the management company more or less dictated terms to her. The SAS negotiations were less prescribed, although the pensioner trustee ensured that the pension fund, the trust, did not get a raw deal in favour of the company. Interesting. The trustees had to have their own bank account, entirely separate from anything else, set up in the name of the trustees, with the trustees as signatories, and all monies had to pass through that account as appropriate transactions took place. The rent is paid over by cheque every quarter to the trustees, and then into the trustees' bank account, from where it is moved either to a deposit account or on for further investment over the longer term. All share, unit trust, investment trust holdings are held in the name of the trustee as nominees for the pension fund. It is very important to recognise that although the investments may be registered in two personal names, the assets need not be personal assets. The assets are the property of the trust and therefore are effectively the property of the collective trustees for the eventual benefit of the pensioners, the beneficiaries.